All right, good evening. Let's all stand together. Sorry, one second. All right, Lord, we come tonight. We praise you. We thank you for all that you've done for us. We lift our hearts up to you as we praise your name. I'm forever thankful. We love you and worship you tonight. Amen. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? King of glory, King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I won't be set free. Yeah. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos? Oh, who brings our chaos back into order? Shining to support a son and daughter, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shine like the sun. In all its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. I sing for all that you've done for me. So we sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King conquered the grave. And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave, and worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. Just to sing for all that you've done for me. Oh, all that you've done for me. Yeah, all that you've done for me. Amen. You were the Word at the beginning. One with God the Lord most. Hidden glory and creation. now revealed in you, oh Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to His. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, love was greater, so what could say us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. Oh, death could not hold you. They'll tore before you. You silenced the blows of sin and grave. And heavens are roaring praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. And you have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory. Yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. No, nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. Oh, you have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Oh, nothing comes to this. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful. Oh, what a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Oh, worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. holy, and we sing, holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder, show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Sing Jesus. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Oh, we live for you. Sing Jesus. Oh, Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Oh, we live for you. We sing, holy, there is no one like, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder, show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Oh, and I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. Now I'll put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. Holy, holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder, show me who you are and fill me with your heart and to those I sing, holy church, and holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those I will build my life upon your love. It is my foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone. Not be we sing holy, we sing holy. There is no one. Around me.
I think that needs to be the prayer of our hearts, every single one of us. We'll build our lives upon his word. Can we make that declaration of our hearts and our minds tonight, church? We'll build our lives upon his word, because holy, there is no one like him. He is worthy of your trust. He's worthy of your trust, church. So we build our lives upon him, knowing that we're safe with him, that he knows tomorrow for us. He knows today for us. He's not surprised by this day in your life. He knew it would come. He knew it would come, whatever it may hold, good or bad or in between. And he's giving you all the grace you need, church, to endure it, to conquer it, to stand in the victory of the cross. Amen, church. Let's sit down. Let's bow our hearts. We'll invite our ushers forward as we take up our offering tonight. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for your word, Lord. It is so worthy to build our lives upon, Lord, because you are worthy. You are holy. We say thank you and amen tonight for your goodness, your faithfulness, for all that you've given us and blessed us with, Lord. We thank you for our health, Father, and we pray for those, our brothers and sisters that are under the weather with the stuff that's going around, Lord. We pray for the Albemont family in the name of Jesus that they be healed tonight, Lord. Give them comfort and restoration in their health, Lord. And all those other brothers and sisters that are struggling with health tonight. And we thank you, Lord Jesus, because you're faithful, Lord. Your word is faithful. Your word is true, Lord. As your people give tonight, Lord, see our hearts as we give. We give with a heart of worship, Lord, because we're grateful, we're thankful for all you've done and continue to do in our lives, Lord. So receive it as such as we give with joy. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. Brennan, for leading us in that sweet time of worship. Isn't the Holy Spirit good? Amen? Isn't his presence sweet? Amen. And all God's people said? Amen. I've got an announcement for you guys tonight. I know we don't do a ton of announcements on Wednesday nights. Usually we leave that for Diana on Sunday mornings and the mail outs and the Facebook pages and whatnot. But we've got a volunteer team grill out coming up, not this Friday, but a week from Friday at Weston Haven Farm Zone in Lynette's Place. So mark it on your calendars if you haven't yet. So if you're currently volunteering in any capacity at LifeStory Church, and or if you would like to volunteer at LifeStory Church in some capacity, we invite you to come. We're going to have a wonderful time of fellowship. We've done this out at Owen and Lynette's Place before, and it's always great. If you've got kids, they've got this incredible treehouse in the back, so everybody's going to have a good time and be blessed. And so I'll just say on that, if you're coming, you'll see the event in the LifeStory Church family page. I encourage you guys to sign up to bring a dessert or a side. Everything else will be provided, drinks and hamburgers and hot dogs and that sort of thing. But if you want to sign up to bring a side or a dessert, please do so and mark your calendar. So it's going to be 6 o'clock on that Friday, April 26th. Are we going to be there? Sounds good. Yeah? Amen? All right. We'll go ahead and release our underground student ministry for tonight. May the Lord plant a seed of his word in your heart that will reap an eternal reward. May you grow in your relationships and fellowship. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said? Amen. Amen. Wonderful, wonderful. So we're going to start a new study tonight. I thought it would be timely to do this study considering the time in history in which we live. There is a period of history that the Bible speaks about more than any other period of history. Does anybody know what era that would be? The end times. That's right. Well, so this era. Good guess. I believe that we're living in the end times. I believe that we're an end times church. I believe that we're at the end, that we've seen prophetic fulfillment, and we're seeing things begin to line up that look like the rapture of the church. The coming of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, is sometime relatively soon. If we are near the return of Jesus, if we are indeed the end times church, wouldn't you be curious to know what Jesus might say to you? Yes? Are y'all going to have to talk to me tonight, all right? Wednesday nights, you're a little sleepy. I know everybody's home from work, and get some coffee in you. Get some coffee in you for me, okay? Wouldn't you want to know what he has to say to you if we're that church, yes?
Yes,
thank you. And if indeed he has something to say specifically to the church, we got to know this, we got to hear it. So did you know that Jesus wrote letters to these churches? Did you know that? Okay, I know this crowd knows that. If you're watching online, did you know that Jesus wrote letters to the end time church? He did indeed. So, well, big answers require big, or big questions require big answers. So tonight we're going to look at the book of Revelation. We're going to begin an exegetical study in the book of Revelation. Yes, we're going to go chapter by chapter, verse by verse, and we're not going to skip anything. This is a book that unfortunately a lot of the church is afraid to study because they don't understand it. They don't know what to do with it. Sadly, a lot of pastors don't know what to do with the book of Revelation, so they stay away from it. They think that their congregants won't be able to handle it because it might be scary as they read it. I'm telling you, there's nothing scary about the book of Revelation if you read it in its context and understand it, and that's what we aim to do, is understand tonight moving forward the book of Revelation. The apocalypse in Greek. We've heard that term, the apocalypse, many times in our culture and in our society, right? In movies, the apocalypse, and it's fearful, and it's everything else, right? Well, apocalypse, in the Greek, it simply means the unveiling. The unveiling, which is a bridal symbolism. The unveiling of the bride. The revelation, the apocalypse. So, often avoided, unfortunately, this book we will study in depth. It's unfortunate, so unfortunate, because it carries a blessing. You know, this is actually a book. So often when somebody first becomes a believer in Christ, you'll find spiritual leaders tell them to start, you know, hey, start somewhere else. Start with the Gospel of Matthew or John. I love to point to John, but, you know, the last place they would ever point them usually would be to the book of Revelation, right? Because, well, it is, you know, it takes some understanding, right? However, I will say this is the one book in the Bible that carries a special blessing for not only the person who reads it, but the person who even hears it being read. So I'm really doing something for you here tonight, guys, all right? I'm delivering God's special blessing to you, not mine, his blessing of anybody who will even hear it be read. In John chapter 16, verses 12 through 14, the Apostle John, recording Jesus' words, said this. He said, I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. And indeed, they could not bear them at this point. At this point, they didn't even understand that he was fulfilling the law and the prophets. It wasn't even until after the resurrections that they began to understand and put the pins together on the big, you know, chalkboard or whatever and say, oh, this was him doing that. And that was when he... Okay, right. It wasn't until after the resurrection that began to happen. So he says, you can't bear them now, but there's more I want to tell you. However, verse 13, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth. Was that some truth, church? How much truth? All truth. For he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will tell you things to come. He will glorify me. Remember that. Things to come. So we're talking prophetic. Things to come. He will glorify me, verse 14, for he will take of what is mine and declare it to you. When Jesus cried, it is finished, he closed out the Levitical requirements of the Torah. He closed them out. He said, it is finished, paid in full. But there were still many things that he needed to say, and he said as much right here. There's still a number of things that he needed to say, and say them he did. He said them through the Holy Spirit to Paul and the apostles. He said them through his revelation to John. Revelation, church, is the consummation of all things. This is what we need to understand in taking on a study like this. It's no small feat to take on this study because it is truly the consummation of all things. I've often borrowed Chuck Missler's line and said that grace is a thread that runs throughout the entire Bible, right? From Genesis all the way through Revelation, it is a scarlet thread. You see it in the Old Testament and in the New Testament, right? This revelation, the unveiling, is the final chapter. Nothing is to be added. Nothing is to be added to God's word after this. There is, let me say this, to a certain sect of Christianity that likes to wander around and try to get a new revelation from God as they're standing before hundreds of people. There is no new revelation, okay? The revelation of God has come, and it is right here in his word. We have the full revelation. We have the full counsel of God in our possession. It is given to us from another dimension, a dimension beyond the physical plane that we are in. He has spoken through his Spirit to his prophets, to his apostles, and written us his word, and it is the full, complete counsel of God. There is no new revelation. This is it, the consummation of all things. It is the only book in the Bible, as I mentioned, that promises a special blessing to the reader or the hearer. There are 404 verses containing over 800 allusions from the Old Testament, if you can believe that. An allusion, if you're not familiar with what that is simply an indirect reference. Dictionary.com defines it as, allusions usually come from a body of information that the author presumes the reader will know. So get this right now, okay? 800 allusions that Jesus has given John to give us, 800 allusions to the Old Testament in Revelation that he is assuming, he is presuming that we will know these allusions and what they're talking about. So how much do you think that Jesus wants us to be studying the full counsel of God? If when he speaks, he makes an allusion, assuming you're going to know his word that he's already given, right? So how much does that speak to the fact that we need to be students of the word of God? Amen? So there's 800 allusions from the Old Testament in this one book. This revelation presents the climax of God's plan for mankind. I'm trying to build it up a lot here, church, because I don't think that I could build it up enough, frankly. I want us to get the magnitude of what we're about to be digging into, the climax of God's plan for mankind. Throughout the Bible, we will see Christ, we see Christ revealed to us. So let me see this list for you guys. I was going to make you guys a worksheet, but we had some technical issues with the computers, and then I didn't get to do it. But I'll have a worksheet for you next week. So take a picture if you want this. Christ revealed to us in the Old Testament. We see Christ in prophecy. I often say that the Old Testament is the New Testament concealed because Jesus Christ is in the Old Testament. But he's in there in prophecy. Hundreds of times prophecies that he fulfilled to the T when he came the first time. So the Old Testament is Christ in prophecy. In the Gospels, we see Christ in history, fulfilling those prophecies historically. In the book of Acts, which we're studying on Sunday mornings right now, we see Christ in the church. And then in the epistles, we see Christ in experience. And here, the apocalyptic prophecy in the book of Revelation, we will see Christ coming in glory. Who's ready to see that? Amen? Amen. So how about these letters? I told you he wrote letters to the end time churches, right? We should read them. Don't you think? Yeah. I think we should read them. We will. We will. But first, a little context. Chapter 1 is context. Chapter 1 acts kind of as a cover letter. You know, if you're writing your resume, you write a cover letter, right? Acts chapter 1 is kind of like a cover letter. And of course, you read that first. So let's begin reading together. To whom was this revelation given? Revelation chapter 1, verse 1. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him, Jesus. That's who him is, Jesus, to show his servants, are you his servants? Amen? To show his servants things which must shortly take place. Don't be confused now, because a lot of times if you just read that on the surface here, you're going to think, oh, well, this was 2,000 years ago, and it was supposed to shortly take place. 2,000 years doesn't seem like shortly, right? So this must be off. Maybe the Bibles forget about it, right? In the Greek, though, this word is tacos, not tacos, all right? Tacos. Must shortly tacos take place. Tacos means events happening rapidly in respect to one another. So in other words, when things start happening, they start happening quickly in a quick succession. Maimonides, an ancient rabbi and prophet, I don't know about prophet, but you know, not a Christian Jewish prophet, he prophesied that when the Gog-Magog War happened, things would happen so quickly in the Gog-Magog War that the whole war would take 12 minutes. I don't know where he came up with that, but we're obviously talking something nuclear at that point, right? But 12 minutes for a war, well, that would be unthinkable except for the day and age that we live in now, and this was hundreds of years ago. In any case, rapid succession to one another. An event happens, the next one happens immediately is what's in view here. So he wanted to show us that these things are going to happen in quick succession. When the first domino falls, in other words, they're going to go, right? So he sent, and he sent and signified by his angel to his servant John. So God gave Jesus things that his servants must know, and he, Jesus, sent and signified it by his angel to John. So we're seeing the progression. God the Father to Jesus, Jesus to an angel, angel to John. Are you following? Number two, verse two. And this angel bore witness to the word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ to all things that he saw. So, verse three is where we find our blessing. Who needs a blessing? You're blessed, you're blessed, you're blessed, you're blessed. Do we do that in this church? No, I don't. Blessed is he who reads and those who hear. Did you hear that? He who reads and those who even hear the words of this prophecy and keep those things which are written in it, for the time is near. The time is near. Keep in mind, even in 90 AD, approximately the time that John the Revelator would have written this, we're early into the age of grace at that point. Even the age of grace, though, is close to the end as far as they're concerned, because they've had 4,000, they've had two different ages. They've had the age of Adam, they've had the age of Torah, and now they're starting out the age of grace, which is the last one, right? So they're going to happen in quick succession. And the time is near. So not only those who hear it, or those that read it, but those who hear it. And now a greeting to the seven churches, verses 4 through 5. John, to the seven churches which are in Asia. And don't think today's Asia, don't think China, Japan, Taiwan, don't think today's Asian continent. This is Asia Minor. This would be Syria. This would be Turkey. This would be Middle Eastern countries to them. That's this Asia, okay? Grace to you and peace. Grace and peace always together, aren't they? Grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come. So he is, he was, and he is to come. And from the seven spirits who are before his throne, seven spirits. And from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness. So who is that that was, who is, who was, and is to come? And then who is this? We've got seven spirits. And then we've also got from Jesus Christ in verse 5, the faithful witness who was the firstborn, the first begotten from the dead, of the dead, and the ruler over the kings of the earth, to him who loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. Seven spirits. In Isaiah, a prophecy of the Messiah detailed the seven spirits that would rest upon him. It comes to us from Isaiah chapter 11, verses 1 through 10. Let's just read it, 10 verses. There shall come forth a rod from the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. Who was that? From Jesse? Who was Jesse? David's father, right? David's dad. So from the line of Jesse, verse 2, the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him. So there's the Spirit of the Lord. The Spirit of wisdom and understanding. The Spirit of counsel and might. The Spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. He delights, verse 3, his delight is in the fear of the Lord, the reverence. And he shall not judge by the sight of his eyes, nor decide by the hearing of his ears. Verse 4, let's keep reading. But with righteousness he shall judge the poor and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. He shall strike the earth with his rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall slay the wicked. Verse 5, righteousness shall be the belt of his loins, and faithfulness the belt of his waist. Verse 6, the wolf also shall dwell with the lamb, the leopard shall lie down with the young goat, the calf and the young lion, and the fatling together, and the little child shall lead them. Verse 7, the cow and the bear shall graze, their young ones shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like the ox. The nursing child shall play by the cobra's hole. That one just gets me after having four kids, right? The nursing child by the cobra's hole. And the weaned child shall put his hand in the viper's den. Can you imagine? They shall not hurt nor destroy in all my holy mountain, for the earth shall be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. The earth is full of the knowledge of the Lord. What a thought. And in that day there shall be a root of Jesse who shall stand as a banner to the people. And this is it right here. For the Gentiles shall seek him. Even the Gentiles shall seek him. Remember John the Revelator, who wrote the Gospel of John to the Gentiles that they may also believe in Jesus Christ. Again, appealing to the Gentiles to believe. And Isaiah. For the Gentiles shall seek him, fulfilling that prophecy. And his resting place shall be glorious. Amen. Seven spirits. Can we see that on the screen? We got seven spirits out of Isaiah chapter 11, verses 1 through 3. What did we see? The Spirit of Yahweh shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom, the Spirit of understanding, the Spirit of counsel, the Spirit of might, the Spirit of knowledge, and the Spirit of the fear of the Lord. Those sound like spiritual giftings that somebody I know imparts to people, doesn't it? Certainly he placed them upon. Who's in the business of placing spiritual giftings upon people? The seven spirits are the Holy Spirit, church. So we find all three persons of God in this greeting. The Father, who was, and will be again. Jesus Christ, who shed his blood for us, and the seven spirits of the Lord. They all three, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, send their greeting to you. Revelation chapter 1, verse 6. And has made us, did Jesus, kings and priests to his God and Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. And the church said, amen. This is a very non-Levitical statement here. And the reason I say that is it used to be, according to the Levitical law, that a king could never be a priest. Could never be a priest. You cannot have a king. We've become prophet, priests, and kings, right? But what we're dealing with right here is kings and priests, simply. According to the Levitical order, you could never be a king and a priest because a king had blood on his hands. And in that ceremony, when the priest would go into the Holy of Holies, right, he could not have that kind of blood on his. Even the priest that obeyed Torah and lived Torah, right, and made all of the right sacrifices for his own shortcomings that were good for 1 year on the Day of Atonement, right, even that priest had to do all of that just to get into the Holy of Holies to sprinkle the blood. And if it was the wrong sacrifice or if he wasn't purified, somehow he'd fall dead and they'd have to pull him out, right, with the rope. So a king could never be a priest, but so here we see, you know, there's only three references of someone being both a king and a priest in the entire Bible. Does anybody know who that is? We've got Melchizedek. Melchizedek would have been a priest of the Melchizedekian order. The Melchizedekian priesthood predated priesthood. We shudders in Daniel chapter 10, verse 6. The right hand and his right hand, don't let that be lost on you. Seven stars, lampstands in the midst and in his hand are these seven stars. His mouth, a two-edged sword comes out of his mouth. Where have we heard that? We've heard that in Ephesians chapter 6, haven't we? And in Hebrews chapter 12. And in Isaiah 49, 2, he judges the unbeliever. The earth is smitten. The Antichrist is consumed. All of this with his mouth, church. And his countenance, we see in Matthew chapter 17, his countenance is as the sun. So these descriptors will be used as identities throughout the rest of the book of Revelation. So this is we'll see this again and again. Now, we then find in verse 19 what essentially amounts to an outline for the entire vision of the book of Revelation. So, verse 19, I'll show you in just a second. Let's just read the verse 19 first. Right, therefore, he says, what you have seen, right? What is now, too, and what will take place later? So Revelation 1:19, I like it in the King James translation better. It reads, and it's not in there. It reads, write the things which thou hast seen, so the things that were, and the things which are, and the things which shall be hereafter. Let's see that graphic on the screen. So we see the divine outline of Revelation 1:19 that he gives us. So this is going to be an outline for the entire vision of the book of Revelation. Chapter 1 is the vision of Christ. That's where we are right now. The things which thou hast seen. Describe what, remember, Jesus, the angel, they're showing John, they're saying, write what you're seeing. Write what you've seen. So, and then write the things which are. What are the things that are? He's writing letters to seven churches. Seven specific churches at that, by the way. So the things that are, we'll cover those letters to the churches in chapter 2 and chapter 3. And then he says, and the things which shall be hereafter. And that is the rest of the book of Revelation from chapter 4 all the way through chapter 22. Hereafter is the word in the Greek metatauta, and it just means after these things. So anytime you see hereafter, or we'll look at it with the Greek metatauta, it means, all right, stopping point. From this point, everything is past. From this point, everything is moving forward. Metatauta, from hereafter. And that will be important in chapter 4, verse 1 in particular. But let's keep reading chapter 1, verse 20. He explains it to us. He gave us all of that, those visuals, all of those descriptive things describing verse 20. He says, the mystery of the seven stars, which you saw in my right hand, now he's explaining, and the seven golden lampstands, the seven stars are the angels of the seven churches. And the seven lampstands, which you saw, are the seven churches. So let's just look at the list here real quick. We have got seven churches. We've got Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamos, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. And of course, we're going to go through each one specifically and talk a lot about each one specifically. But why these seven churches? We're talking on Sunday mornings right now a whole lot about Antioch, aren't we? Antioch was the hub of the, really, of when the gospel really took off into the rest of the world, into the outer reaches of the world, and the Gentiles coming to Christ at record numbers. Jerusalem, of course, where it all began. Why not Jerusalem? Why not Antioch? Why these seven churches? Well, there's a few reasons. One, they were local. These are actual churches. Sir William Ramsay researched archaeologically each church, and they found them. These were real churches, okay? So they're local, they're admonitory. These churches, number two, these churches, each message applies to every other church. So it's each church gets a letter, and it's for that church, but each other church can learn from it, and it's applied to each other church. It's even applied to us today, because we can look at the seven churches as we study, and we can say, are we that kind of church? We don't want to be that kind of church. Are we this kind of church? We want to be this kind of church, right? So we can do that. But they're also what you would call homiletic. In other words, he that hath an ear is repeated over and over again. That means that the message applies to us. So it applies to each church specifically, but then to each other of the other seven churches. If you got a letter, it applies to the other six, but then it also applies to us today. So he was very specific and deliberate with picking these churches, because they were dealing with stuff that we deal with and have dealt with, by the way, over the centuries. There's the conjecture, and perhaps we'll talk about this as well, that each different church represents an era of church history throughout the last 2,000 years, as well as being local churches that did actually struggle with these things, as well as being instruction for us, because we also struggle with these things today. So nothing is accidental. I will add this to you. There is a constellation in the heavens directly above this area of the world, and it's a constellation called the Pleiades, and it looks like this. And if we look on a map, where these cities are in the area, it seems as though there is a map in the heaven of these seven stars, these seven lampstands, even or lights in the heavens, whatever you want to call them, seven stars of the Pleiades, and we've got seven churches directly below, and they seem to line up perfectly. I mean, that's crazy, right? I mean, I didn't come up with that. I'll tell you, nothing church is accidental. So why did God choose these seven churches? Because he's intentional. Nothing is accidental. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 17 reads, "Now to the King eternal, the immortal, invisible, to God who alone is wise." And isn't that the truth? Just when we think we've got it figured out, he's like, you don't have it figured out, right? You're still learning. If you think you've arrived, that's when you're done. We never stop learning. You could study this book, this Bible, your entire life and scratch the surface, I'm telling you. So, but we see design elements in each of the letters to the seven churches. Can we see that on the screen? As we study through, it's just, again, he's intentional. So we're going to see, like we see an outline through Revelation. If you're in English class, there's an outline. We're going to see, again, design elements in each letter. He's going to name the church. He offers a title of Christ is chosen. So he references himself in a different way, offers a different title. Then he gives them a commendation. You've been good at this. Good job. Pat on the back. Most of them anyway, right? But then he offers concern. But I am concerned about this. And then he'll give an exhortation. And then at the last, he'll give a promise to the other. So this is what you're struggling with. But if you can overcome it, I've got a promise for you. And then he'll end it and close it up by saying, "He that hath an ear, hear what the Spirit says to the churches." Seven times elsewhere in the New Testament does he say, "He that hath an ear, hear." So, it's going to be a good study. Are you ready to hear what he has to say, church? You ready to hear what he has to say to the end time churches? Well, next week we're going to do that, all right? We're going to do that next week because I don't have time to jump into that just yet. Because we're going to go deep into this study, and we're going to give you the historical background of each church as well. So it's going to be a fun study. I will tease you, though. I'll say this. Every church is surprised by the report they get on how they're doing. Each church is surprised. The churches are like, man, we're doing great. Now we had like 3,000 people last Sunday. This is awesome. And we've got, you know, we've got an awesome cornhole team going, you know. We've got great canoeing trips. We've got, you know, man, we're just, you know, we're knocking it out of the park. But Jesus is like, mm-mm, right? And then there's this little church that's got, they think they've got nothing going on. They think they're persecuted. They think, they're like, we're just weak and we're small. And he says, you are mighty. You are mighty, right? So every church, it's going to be awesome. Each church is surprised by how they're doing. The churches that thought they were doing great, they're shocked to find out that they're doing terribly. And the churches that thought they were struggling are shocked to find out how well they're doing. So with that, I want to pivot tonight into a bit of a prophecy update, because Jesus is coming back soon. So, you know, I don't want to like forget to mention anything to you guys, right? Is that a good plan? I'll say this, you know, I take my position as your pastor seriously. Pastor means that I'm a shepherd in a sense. That's what it means. That means if a wolf comes around, I use one end of the stick to whack him on the head. And then the other stick has got that hook. So if you start to wander off, I try to hook you and pull you back in, right? So that's my job, is to walk the fences and be your shepherd and be your protector, protect you from bad doctrine, bad teaching, and that sort of thing. It's also a responsibility of mine to be a watchman on the wall. And that's really a responsibility that every single one of us have. But as a pastor, I think all the more since I've got a microphone and you don't, right? I have to be the one to say, hey, danger is coming, or hey, Jesus is coming, right? So, ultimately, the word tells us that if the watchman sees trouble coming and he does not sound the alarm, then the blood of the people is on his hands. But if he sounds the alarm, then that's what I'm going to do. So some people have asked me, they asked me a while back, honestly, if I had heard of a figure in Israel that was claiming to be the Antichrist. And to be honest with you, I had not. That the Temple Institute and these people were claiming was, well, to them, the Messiah, right? And to be honest with you, I had not. So, I said, no, I've not heard of that, really. And to be honest with you, I didn't follow up and look into it either. But I have since, it has found me. So, we can have fun conjecturing as we see Ezekiel 38 and 39, lining up, these nations lining up for the first time in history against Israel, right? As we see the one world order lining up, the global elite bankers aligning their utopia, you know, we talked about that a little bit on Sunday. So we've got Amalek in Iran raising its head against the Jewish people, with Russia in tow potentially, which would be Ezekiel 38, 39. Or we've got the Edomite Palestinians that are rising up, that could be in a Psalm 83 war if we're off on our timing. And then we've also got the global elites that the Jews in Israel today, the Hasidic Jews, they believe that the global elites are actually masquerading, Edomites masquerading as Jews, that are the Jews that are not Jews. So we got a lot of pieces of the puzzle on the table, don't we? So in the midst of all of that, people love to conjecture, well, hey, I mean, I don't know who you think the Antichrist is, but I'm thinking Obama looks like the Antichrist, right? We've heard that a little bit, right? I don't know who you think the Antichrist is, but I'm thinking that, you know, that president of France is looking like that Macron looks like he might be the Antichrist. I've heard that one too. I don't know who you think the Antichrist is, but King Charles is looking a lot like the Antichrist. Have we heard that? Yes? So there's a lot of that going around. And so somebody had mentioned to me, you know, there's this guy that the Temple Institute associated people are lifting up as potentially being the Antichrist. Have you heard about this? I have not heard about this. I didn't follow up on it. But again, the information has found me. So, and it's only significant because it came to me, because I'm just going to be dead honest with you guys. The NFL draft is coming up, and I love the NFL, and I'm a little embarrassed to admit, but I love the Denver Broncos. And they are releasing their new uniforms on April 22nd. And I was like, oh, April 22nd. I was like, that's only 5 days away. I was like, something else is on April 22nd. Oh, Passover is on April 22nd. And so I had a little chuckle in my office, right? In any case, on April 22nd, I discovered this afternoon that the Temple Institute, we talked about this again a few weeks back, that the Temple Institute, they have erected an altar on the Mount of Olives. It's there. And they have done so to sacrifice specifically a red heifer to purify the land of Israel and the Temple Mount, to make ready the people and the nation, make ready for the third temple that they want, right? So we know that that's coming. We speculated that perhaps it would have been done, I think on March 29th is when we speculated it might have been done, because that was the Sabbath of the red heifer. And when we talked about this, I think it was like the 26th or something to that effect. I might be off a little bit, but we know that's coming up. Well, the Temple Institute, they have actually filed the paperwork. They had to file the paperwork with the city of Jerusalem to have that public sacrifice. And they filed that paperwork on April 4th to have that sacrifice on April 22nd on the Mount of Olives on Passover. So they and we know that according to Hamas, according to their own words, the whole reason they attacked Israel on October 7th was because, according to the head of Hamas, was because the Jews brought the red cows, and they know what that means. That means the Al-Aqsa Mosque wiped away for a temple to be placed where it's standing today. And they're like, it's now or never, it's go time, and so they go. So all of that is incredibly relevant. We're looking at potentially a red heifer sacrifice, which has to be done in order to purify the land for the third temple to be rebuilt. And then we've got this headline on the screen. Can we see this? This is actually all the way back from 2022, where a famous Israeli rabbi comes out in the news publicly and says that he's already holding meetings with the Messiah. Now, keep in mind, the Messiah to the Jewish people is not Jesus. He is not Yeshua HaMashiach. No. He is a different guy altogether. So this guy says he's already holding meetings with him. And maybe he's just an old crazy guy, right? Maybe he's seeing things or hearing things. But this is a famous rabbi, and unfortunately, he's not the only one in that community. He will not be the Son of God. They also go on to say, keep in mind that the Messiah will not be a savior. The rabbis go on to say in this article, and I don't have time to read it all to you, so I'll just share with you what I've read this afternoon. They said, keep in mind the term Messiah has been co-opted by the Christians, they say. When the Christians say Messiah, it suggests salvation. That is not at all what we hope to gain from our Messiah. No, the Messiah simply means Messiah in Hebrew, means anointed one. So we just need our anointed one to come, our anointed one. So Messiah to the Jews, keep in mind, is not the Son of God. Now, in the Old Testament, Jesus was prophesied, Yeshua was prophesied to be the Son of God, Son of God, Son of God. Guess what? When he came and said, I'm the Son of God, they stopped saying Son of God. Okay, they transformed the religion, and I believe 93 AD at the Council of Yamnia, when they changed the religion from what it was in the Old Testament into a religion of charity. It essentially became a cult of true Old Testament Judaism at that point. Okay, so from that point forward, they're not expecting the Son of God to really come. They're expecting a man to come. So let's see this first one on the screen. This is from Chabad.org, their own work, right? So hard to see on the screen. The people at home will love it, though. I'll read it to you for in the house. Mashiach, also known as Messiah, they write, is the long-awaited Jewish leader who will usher in an era of world peace and godly awareness. The Jewish Messiah is a human being. Did you get that? A human being, a descendant of King David, who will lead the Jewish people back to the land of Israel, where they serve God in peace, leading the nations of the world in attaining an understanding of a creator. Messiah will also, and this is big, rebuild the holy temple in Jerusalem, establishing an era of peace and prosperity that will endure forever. Next graphic. Mashiach is, again, a human being born in a normal fashion of human parents. Again, you see what they're doing? They're creating a discrepancy so there's no confusion. This is not a virgin birth. This is not Yeshua HaMashiach. Normal human birth, human parents. The only qualification about his origins is that he is a descendant of King David, though the lineage, through the lineage of his son Solomon. From his birth onwards, his righteousness will increase continually, and by virtue of his deeds, he will merit sublime levels of spiritual perfection. Mashiach in every generation is the next subtitle. Any time is a potential time, they say, for the coming of Mashiach. This does not mean, however, that at the appointed time he will suddenly emerge from heaven to appear on the earth. No, not from heaven, right? Not us going there or him coming down. They're doubling down. Again, not Yeshua, right? On the contrary, they say, Mashiach, their anointed one, is already on earth, a human being of great saintly status, appearing and existing in every generation. In every generation is born a progeny of Judah, fit to be Israel's Mashiach. And I'll say this. This lines up perfectly with the hypothesis that I've heard from many, many brothers in Christ and teachers in Christ that say, I believe there is an Antichrist on the earth in every generation because Satan doesn't know when it's really going to be go time for the Father. Have you heard that? Well, for them, they're saying their Messiah, there's always been, every generation. Why? Because David's lineage has just continued and continued and continued. Well, can we see this next graphic on the screen? Reputable scholars and researchers worldwide have devoted their careers to studying royal and ancient dynasties. Years ago, several had concluded that the Dayans of Aleppo are the one and only unbroken male pedigree establishing the Messianic dynasty. A well-respected archaeologist, Sloes, I guess we'll say, a historian and scholar writer wrote an article titled, Where Are the True Descendants of King David That Appeared in the Jewish it appeared in the Jewish Morning Journal, September 1st, 1933. Sloes researched families including Halprin, descendants of Rashi, Abarbanel, Don Yehiya, and other families. He concluded that the Dayan family, constituted the only messianic line from King David. So they found the line to David. Next graphic. It says, Yitzhak Kaduri, by the way. Yitzhak Kaduri was a Jewish rabbi that claimed to have seen Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ came to him in visions, and he met him. And he refused to reveal the identity of the Messiah, Jesus Christ. And he wrote it down on a piece of paper, and he said to his number one student, and he said, I want all of you, my students, that after I die, look, after I die, I'm not going to die till Ariel Sharon dies, I've been told by God. But when he dies, the lion, Ariel Sharon, He did die. He was about to die. He gave them this piece of paper, wrote the name of the Messiah on it. He said, don't open it until I looked at my wife's face and I remembered I was wrong. Don't open it until after Ariel Sharon passes away. Well, they opened it, and the name of Yeshua was on the paper. And of course, thousands of people were in the street to see this letter opened. And when it was opened, and it was the name of Yeshua, they just thought, crazy old man, and walked away. I mean, they were in the streets to hear the name. Well, this movement didn't stop there that Yitzhak was a part of. This will explain it for you. When Yitzhak died, one of his sons was supposed to run with the torch, but they refused. I wonder why. Maybe because they knew, well, this is the wrong lane to run in. Maybe Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior, right? Is the Messiah. But they didn't. In 1968, the torch was picked up by Yosef Dayan. Now, he is too old for the job, so the torch was passed to his son. Hananel Diane, in roughly 2017, or shortly before that, whoever is king of Israel is also Messiah in modern Judaism. Verified patrilineal descent, father to son, patrilineal descent, father to son, all the way back to 90 generations to King David from Judah. Once you understand what the Jews believe, finding the Antichrist is fairly simple. He's a direct line to King David. He is the 90th generation from King David, is what they're saying. Next graphic on the screen. Yitzhak Dayan was considered heir in 1933 by Jewish rabbis as the Davidic dynasty's heir and the king of Israel. But after his death, none of his three sons pursued their father's dynastic. My heir, not Kedori. Dayan, Yitzhak Dayan. But after his death, none of his three sons pursued their father's dynastic claims. Then, in 1968, another family member picked up the claim to the throne. The Dayan, this is at the bottom I wanted to get to, the Dayan family appears to have the best claim to Israel's throne, according to the Jewish Morning Journal, September 1st, 1933, all the way back. So this guy, man, that's of this seed line, will be a guy that just simply does things. He's not the son of God. He just, whoever does this and who does that, right? As far as they're concerned, he will, you know, he'll live a good Torah life. He'll be the one, apparently, that slays the red heifer, because from the time of Moses, there have been 9 red heifers slain. According to their prophet, Maimonides, the 10th red heifer would be slayed by none other than the Messiah himself. And here we are, they filed the paperwork to slay the 10th red heifer on April 22nd. And, well, the Messiah's got to be here to do it, right? I don't see the Jewish Messiah anywhere, unless, of course, this is the guy they're propping up to be that guy. Kabod, next graphic. Kabod Lubavitch is an organization in Israel that has been driving for the Third Temple for years. They actually picked a guy to be Messiah back in 2002, we should note. And when he died, they said, well, he just didn't get the job done. So we'll pick another guy. Well, so, you know, asterisks behind that one. In any case, this organization has chosen Hananel Dayan, 90th in the generation from Daniel, to be the Mashiach, the Messiah King. And I will not be surprised whatsoever if they have him up on the Temple Mount, up on the Mount of Olives on April 22nd. Interestingly enough, another point of interest is that they actually believe that, and this is according to Israel 365, which is a reputable source of information out of Israel, messianic information out of Israel from what I've experienced. They believe that Netanyahu will actually be the one to hand the scepter to the Messiah, the son of David. They believe, those who have done this seed line study, that Netanyahu is actually a descendant, direct descendant of Jonathan's line. So here we have a direct descendant of Jonathan's line, according to them, Temple Institute and all of these Chabad organizations, direct descendant from Jonathan. So they believe he'll hand the scepter over to this Hananel, who will be their Mashiach, that he will hand it over. He will serve as the second Mashiach, what do they call it? Mashiach ben David will be their Messiah. Netanyahu, they say, is clearly fulfilling this function of what they've prophesied the Nathaniel figure to do. Interestingly enough, they've got another guy over there named Rav Shlomo Yehuda Biri that they believe is going to be the Elijah to the Messiah. This Rav Shlomo Yehuda Biri, they say he's already done 5 miracles, which they say qualifies him as Elijah, as the Elijah type. He's done 5 certified miracles. And he is pointing to Hananel Dayan as the Mashiach. So do with that what you will. Because it can, could still be, it could still be Obama, I suppose, right? Something to think about in any case. There is when you've got, what you think, what you need to understand is that the Jewish, the Antichrist is going to be Jewish. There's just no other way that you're going to have the Jewish people accept the Mashiach if he is not Jewish. So that's something that we need to factor in. And of course, you trace the lineage of King Charles, and many people have done that. And he sure looks like that, but he also looks like he's dying now, doesn't it? I don't know, maybe that fits somehow too. But let me just add this on. I'll close tonight with this last graphic. How close are we? How close are we? Let's just take a real legit look at how close we are. We have literally got somebody from the line of David, not proven to be the 90th generation descendant from the line of David, claiming to that he's in line to be the Mashiach. Oh, by the way, his father is on the Sanhedrin. He's a member of the Sanhedrin that was reestablished in 2017. So he's pushing his son to be Mashiach. We've got a figure that they believe is going to be the Elijah figure in place. They're all saying it, and then you've got them claiming that Netanyahu is, in any case, how close are we? Well, I'll tell you, the Levitical priests are trained. They're trained. The temple utensils are ready. The high priest is ready. A 6.5-ton stone altar for daily sacrifices is ready to go. It's ready to go. They did, 2 years ago, they revealed that. Kosher red heifers are available. Top rabbis are holding meetings, they claim, with the Messiah, the Antichrist. The third temple, by the way, is prefabricated in different sections and ready to go. They'll be able to erect it very quickly whenever that Mashiach figure brings it about for them. A high-speed train to the temple started in April of 2023, and the Abraham Accords are available to be confirmed or strengthened. Additionally, Noahide laws are in place and ready to be enforced upon the world. Noahide laws, which, by the way, are not friendly at all to Christians. So with that, we'll close. I hope I've piqued some of your interest. I hope I've piqued your interest tonight in our study in Revelation, and perhaps I've piqued your interest into looking into some things in regards to where we might be in history. We'll invite Brennan forward tonight as we close. So, God wants you to know what's going on. That's one thing we know. He said, should I hide from Abraham what I'm going to do? Should I hide from Abraham, my friend, what I'm going to do? Are you a friend of his? Are you a friend of Jesus's? If you're a friend of the Lord's, you call him friend, he calls you friend. Then he wants you to know what he's doing. You might not know exactly when, you know. And so we have fun with conjecture. Some conjecture simply fun, some conjecture quite compelling, right? In any case, I believe he wants us to know what he's doing. And I believe he wants us to know the season in which he's doing. I believe he told us all these things. Remember, what do we begin in Revelation with, right? He said, tell my servants, tell them this so they can know what I'm going to do and what's going to happen. It's the whole purpose for the revelation. It's the whole purpose for the letter, is that his servants, you and me, would know what he's doing. When we see these things happening, we won't be surprised. And when we see these things happen, we would not be fearful, but we would be excited, because we know that he's not promised wrath for his people. We're not going to suffer this tribulation. When we get into chapter 4 on, I'll just give you a little teaser. The church is gone. From chapter 4, verse 1 on, the church is gone. And the wrath that is poured out upon the earth over and over and over again through the book of Revelation, he refers to the people that dwell upon the earth as those that dwell upon the earth. Gone are the phrases like my beloved, my servants, my, you know. So the terms that are so often used of the church throughout the New Testament, those terms are absent for the tribulation of the church. So we need not fear. So as we see these things happening, we should be excited and say to ourselves, could we really be the generation that sees thousands of years of prophecies come together, the culmination of all things in the history of the world? Are we really that generation that's here to see this happening? What an honor. And how exciting. How should that motivate us to tell everybody far and wide about the love and grace of Jesus Christ? Amen? Amen. With every eye closed and every head bowed, if you're here tonight and the Lord's moving on your heart in any way, I just want you to surrender to Him what He's calling you to surrender. If He's calling you to a deeper study, ask Him to lead you. Surrender that to Him. Surrender, make a commitment to Him that you're going to surrender your time to Him. You're going to surrender your time to Him to meet Him in relationship, in prayer, and in study of His Word. Whatever it is, let's pray. Heavenly Father, where Your people come to You tonight and they lay down whatever You're calling upon them to lay down. We say thank You and we say amen, Lord. We're excited, Lord, that You chose us to be alive here and now in this generation, Father, regardless of how close it is. We know it's close. We know it's close. We know they're nearer now than they were before, Lord, and we know that the age of grace from a simple calendar standpoint is at an end, Lord. We know we're in striking distance of Your divine plan coming to fulfillment, Lord. We surrender our hearts to You, our lives to You, Lord Jesus. We lay them down. We bring our petitions before Your throne with arms linked, hearts mended together in symphony in Jesus' name. And if you're here this morning, if you're here tonight, and you've never given your heart to Jesus Christ, there's no better time than right now. If you're watching this online, if you've never overcome your skepticism, your doubt, your unwillingness to say, I need a Savior, if you never surrendered that, I pray that tonight you acknowledge, I'm not righteous, I'm not perfect, but God is righteous and He is perfect. And I've not hit that bar, but Jesus hit that bar for me. And He took the punishment, He took the wrath, He took it for me that I wouldn't have to, that if I would just accept Him. If I would just accept Him and be with Him. If you haven't done that, just accept Him and you can be with Him for eternity. If that's you here tonight or watching online, say this prayer with us as we pray. If you're here in this room, no one's looking around, just raise your hand and give it to Him. If you've never done that, give it to Him tonight. If you need a prayer of recommittal, say that right now. Just raise your hand. Let's pray. Jesus, say it out loud. Jesus, I believe You're the Son of God. I believe that You love me. I believe You died on the cross for my sin. I believe You rose from the grave on the third day. That You're living forever. And I will live forever with You because of what You've done for me. I trust You. I believe You've gone to prepare a place for me and that You're coming back for me. Seal my heart. Make me new. Walk with me all the days of my life as I pledge to walk with You. In Jesus' name, all God's people said, amen. May the Lord bless you, keep you, make His face shine upon you, go before you, follow after you. May you prosper in all you do. Go in grace. In Jesus' name, we love you guys. Good night.